enjoyed visiting North Pole City. A very big Christmas store full of bright lights, Christmas trees, and decorations. Of course, Santa would always take time from his busy day to talk with all the children who were there.
How are you? What's your name?
Natalie.
Natalie, how old are you? You're three now?
You are sure growing up fast, Santa said. What do you want for Christmas? A doll, Natalie replied. A doll? Well, of course, said Santa. Silly me, I knew that, but...
What color eyes should she have? Should she have brown or blue? Brown eyes, and what color hair would she have?
Slowly, one by one, each and every kid in North Pole City made their way into Santa's lap. And this is where Santa's story begins.
How are you, mister?
Kai.
Kai, is that your name?
Mm-hmm.
How old are you?
Five.
You are five. And what do you want?
A number of years ago, there was this tall gentleman with a white beard and white hair that looked just like Santa Claus, and people started coming into my office and say, you've got to see this guy. He looks just like Santa Claus.
Thank you.
I've talked with a lot of people, and when I met Dan,
how are you?
I knew that this was the man that I wanted representing Christmas here at North Pole City. When it comes to his love of Christ, he just has such a special heart.
He has an
undying love to always tell people the story of the birth of Christ, and that's one thing that makes him so special.
Why did we call the very first Christmas, Christmas? Do you know who was born on that day? Yes, Jesus. It was Jesus' birthday, wasn't it?
As we tell the story, we hope that when they've heard it, they understand that the first Christmas was the day Jesus was born, and that he was God's gift to the world.
On Christmas morning, after you wake up, before you open your presents, do Santa a favor. Sing baby Jesus a happy birthday song. Can you do that? Will you? Okay.
Every morning, Santa enjoyed sitting in his favorite rocking chair at his city home. Right smack in front of his little greenhouse was a school bus stop.
Well, my wife and I made a decision, a conscious decision, to live here. This is a ministry. Mustard Seed is a ministry created to work in this one area, about eight or nine neighborhoods in the 73114 zip code.
My wife Gay and I, about 6 years ago, we both looked at how blessed we were financially and said, you know, we have plenty. We have all that we need. What we really ought to do is take anything over and above what we need and give it back to something that God would want us to give it to. My wife decided that she was willing to move from our comfortable home in Edmond into this neighborhood and to establish Mustard Seed. So we did that, and we live now on donations.
On school days, Santa loved to meet and greet the kids on their way to school. They all loved Santa. He was always doing good things for them.
There's anywhere from 12 to 15 kids every day who catch the bus here.
Good.
Good morning, girls. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
And I'm trying to get to know them. I'm trying to be out here as much as I can so I can get involved a little bit in their lives. Social studies, is that hard for you? You just don't like it?
One in six kids are being raised by a grandparent because the parents aren't available. The other children who are being raised there are being raised by a single parent, and that single parent is working very hard, usually two jobs, to make ends meet.
Just one. All right. How's that? You all right? Okay. We've got great kids here. They study hard, they try. We just don't want them to give up. We don't want them to get involved in stuff that's going to direct their lives away from the success that they can be. Bye, kids. See ya.
Second thing that we're trying to do is develop a mentoring program so that the 7,000 kids in that neighborhood who could benefit from a mentor will have someone, a life coach, to help the mom or help the dad raise that kid. Somebody else in their life to be important to them.
It's been a changing neighborhood, though, and there are so many rental houses. A lot of people who used to own and live here have died or moved away. So now there's a lot more rental. And when you have that imbalance of rental, you've got a less stable neighborhood.
It's been coming for some time. Its demographics are rugged. There are about 17,000 people who live there, about 58% poverty, crime is high, home ownership is low. There's just lots of challenges. But there are also lots of assets. There are 750 businesses in this neighborhood. We're trying to tap into those businesses and get those business owners to create job opportunities for people who live right there. We're trying to increase home ownership.
This is going to be the place for me till I croak.
Good. This is nice to see this.
I found this one. I thought, oh, this would be a great spot for me to be a home. So he actually helped me with my financing, helped get the leases and everything going just so that I could qualify and
get
it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome. You're welcome. That's official.
Well, this is Velma Dennis's house. Actually, the one next door was where she was living, and it had a fire a couple years ago. So she moved in right here. And two summers ago, a mission group of youth came and painted her house, replaced a lot of the clapboard siding, and also built a ramp for her.
So we work with seniors to help repair their homes and keep them in good shape so that they can enjoy them until the end of their lives.
Good morning, Velma.
Good morning.
Good to see you. How you doing?
I'm doing fine. How you
feeling?
Doing?
Well?
I feel pretty good this morning.
Good. Good. Already had your breakfast?
Yeah, I've already had breakfast.
And my wife, who helped me found Mustard Seed, was diagnosed with cancer 2 years ago and died this past spring in March. Her willingness to serve, her willingness to live there, her willingness to become a neighbor and to make this happen was a great inspiration to me. I wouldn't have done it without her.
That'll be warm.
Without her willingness. I love hearing children's stories. About themselves or about their families.
I just want $20.
$20, okay.
If we ask them enough questions, you'll generally get something humorous.
I see.
That's what I want.
Okay, and why do you want $20?
And something really special.
That's very nice of you.
I do because my parents have never done anything for Christmas when they were an adult.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's nice of you to do that.
And every circumstance a child can encounter, we see that child on our lap. We see healthy kids, we see children who are not healthy, we see children who aren't going to be here next year.
He's quit breathing twice.
Has he?
We meet children with special needs.
But he's okay now, and he has been okay a long time.
Last year here at North Pole City, in one day, I had three different sets of children who had lost a parent within the last 3 months.
What's your favorite doll?
I like one with red hair and green eyes.
Oh, pretty. That's nice. Let me see your eyes.
My main purpose with these children is to love them.
You have pretty green eyes yourself.
And I have a little moment, maybe a minute or two or three with each one, to establish that love relationship and to give them that love and to make them feel good about me and about themselves and about Jesus.
He's nice, I love him, and he gives presents to kids that are not good, and I deserve him.